I have a gal for you, Joan, and her name is Wendy Hirschberg. She's always been a sculptor, and now she's working with puppets and does shows, and she'll tell you all about it.
Welcome again, once again, to the Mind Body Home Show, Growing into Health. I'm so excited. And today in the studio, we have a special guest. And thank you, I want to say thank you to Hanneke van Velzen for tagging today's guest. Her name is Wendy Hirschberg, and she is an incredible woman who has a very interesting background. She is a diversity inclusion specialist, a leader in her field. Today, Wendy, we're going to talk about how this world that you started off in, which was the arts, turned into diversity and inclusion. Where did that all begin for you?
My mother was a painter. So I thought that people sort of normally made art, at, you know, like I'd come home from elementary school and my mother would like smell like turpentine, and I just thought, okay, moms cook, they sort of do things around the house and they paint, you know. So to me, making art seemed like just something that you do. And my mother absolutely encouraged me because when I was about three, she gave me clay, like self-hardening clay, and I made a little mother and child sculpture, and she was so excited that, you know, you're a little kid and you grow up with this excitement about making things from your mom, kind of hooked me.
Beautiful.
So that's sort of the beginning of my being a sculptor.
And then that sort of shaped a little bit of your youth as well, like, so you didn't stop there, it was just a continuation for them?
Yeah, I actually made sculpture mostly around people's birthdays. I would make gifts and things when I was a teenager. And then I actually went to college as a European history major. So I was in the school system in the years when you had alternative programs. So I was like, instead of taking math and science at a certain point, I was taking film studies and anthropology. So somehow got interested in history. And so I didn't think I was gonna study art when I started college, but in my second year of college, I had sort of an aha experience of taking a class with a really wonderful professor, and I was like, oh, okay, this is really what I wanted to do.
So it was really felt, you felt that moment shift for you, and you decided that was your pathway into this world of art and sculpture. And wow. And so did you take it any further? Like, where did you go with that at that point?
Yeah, I did actually. I left college and I went to the New York Studio School, which in the years I was there was not an accredited school, so it was essentially kind of leaving college. I went to art school for 2 years there, basically working from models, 8 hours a day, 5 days a week. It was a very intense place to go to school.
Models meaning people?
People.
Okay.
Yeah. So figure models, you know, and that was pretty confusing because I had made a lot of sculpture that wasn't directly from life. You know, it wasn't with models. I just invented my characters when I was growing up. So it was a kind of confusing time, but I ended up sticking with it, and I graduated, eventually piled all my credits into Queens College, and I graduated from Queens College with a BA in studio art. And I was out of school for a bunch of years and went back on an alumni scholarship to Queens College and got my master's in sculpture. From there.
And so starting with the figure, you did you feel that was the figure the primary inspiration?
Really, it was in school. I mean, I had made figures of my own invention before, you know, studying from models. But yes, I did primarily focus on figures. I didn't actually stick with realistic modeling from life. I invented my own figurative sculpture, you know, in graduate school. And I've done a lot of different kinds of sculpture since then.
Very nice. And the sculpture that is, you're talking about the medium that you're using is still clay, or is it
multimedia? Yeah, I shifted. I worked for a sculptor after college, undergrad, and during that time I learned a lot of how to cast bronze and, well, I didn't have a foundry, but I learned how to manage to afford to cast bronze by doing a lot of the labor myself. And I also learned about plaster molds and a lot of different sort of traditional materials. But as I evolved over the years, I became a found object artist, and then I was using materials pretty much from the hardware store. So it's evolved, you know, if you look at my body of work, you might think I'm different artists in different eras.
Well, that is a trend. They're great. We transition, we change over periods of time, right? So
absolutely,
we are attracted to different things at different times of
mm-hmm.
our life.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm curious, this at some point there was a career change for you. And this is where I'm curious. As a diversity inclusive leader, when did that, like, how did that
Okay, that's
pivot?
That's a funny, you know, I think I used to think that the fact that I got into the field of diversity inclusion was a sort of happy accident. But in retrospect, as an older person, I look back and I realize, kind of trace the roots of it. But the short version of it is, I was this artist person. I had this crazy series of jobs. My roommate said, you know, I think you need to get health insurance, because I was doing stuff that was physical and she thought something, you know, could happen to me, et cetera. So she helped me get a job at an organization called Catalyst, where she was working. And Catalyst is still existing. It's a national, or actually probably now international, nonprofit organization that has a mission to advance women into business leadership roles. And so I started there as sort of a low man on the totem pole, but I stayed for 15 years because I had a part-time job with benefits, so I could work 3 days a week and do my sculpture.
Beautiful.
And it was really an education for me.
Mm-hmm. And I find it fascinating that today, right now, we are lifting women up to these leadership roles. And for you, this was going back to...
I started in 1982.
Mm-hmm. And there's, I'm sure that this Catalyst, like you said, is still around. So it's now more prevalent than ever. It's
mm-hmm.
everywhere we look now. It's about inclusive and diversity and women and raising our bar, raising the female, the feminine energy to another level. And so from there, from Catalyst, you went to
Ernst & Young. Yeah, what happened was, I mean, Catalyst evolved. It was really focused a lot on white women. It wasn't really focused on the broader dimensions of diversity for many years, as the whole time in the world was changing in the US, let's say, around women's issues. But by the time we got to the mid-90s, it had created the first research reports on women of color in corporate America, and specifically looked at African-American, Latino, you know, and Asian women. And then it's evolved from there into a diversity inclusion organization after I left. But I worked with a woman there who got brought to Ernst & Young and brought me into Ernst & Young, into the office of the chairman, which was a pretty dramatic change from a 50-person women's organization. So we had a lot of adventures, and we really actually did some very innovative thing. Initially focused on the fact that there were only 5% of the partners of Ernst & Young in the U.S. who were female. So the then chairman really wanted to change that, and that was our initial mission. But over time, it grew into a truly diversity inclusion effort, and I stayed through the journey there. So it became inclusive of all the issues, race, ethnicity, LGBTQ, ally relationships, you know, for all the different kinds of identity, disabilities, which is called accessibility at Ernst & Young, just kept expanding. Mm. And now there's actually socioeconomic focus in the, you know, these issues are really so broad. So I really did, I guess, go on the historic journey of the field.
Today, how where you were just beginning at Ernst & Young is just, what do you see different from when you started into today?
Well, you know, you can look at it in sort of slices, I would say. You know, I think with, I would say, the last 6 years of my career at Ernst & Young, heavily focused on race and ethnicity related issues. You know, this is during the time that, if I just focus on, you know, African American or black, we called it black population because we had West Indian, Caribbean cultures, we had people who are African, people who are African American. So if I just focus on that network, which I did get very close to a lot of people, a lot of wonderful people at EY, you know, that's during the years like Ferguson and all these events. And, I mean, George Floyd, of course, is after I left, but just there's just so much going on. The Asian issues in the U.S. now have completely exploded, but all these issues were, in, you know, really many years in the making. You know, there's nothing new about a lot of the problems related to diversity and inclusion. So it's a slow change process, but it's certainly, you know, certainly the statistics of, let's say, representation of women have changed a lot in the years. But there's still so many subtle barriers depending on your identity in the work world in general.
Yeah, and the identity and how we identify ourselves is really what comes from inside of ourselves, right? So the Mind Body Home show, we focus on bringing the inside out, and then how does that reflect within our in our home? And so being working with different diverse backgrounds, you can almost see that we bring ourselves to wherever we go. And so whether you're Asian, African American, West Indian, Latino, I think that from your perspective, being a diversity inclusive focus on the human and seeing how they individually are different and how they bring themselves out and what they're bringing towards them, right, is very interesting to me, and how you are able to relate to those individuals. And yeah,
I think I actually did some thinking, you know, in our talks about what we were going to discuss today, you know, and sometimes I don't pause and think too much about how I ended up being able to do the things that I've done in the field of diversity and inclusion as, you know, a white Jewish woman from, you know, Long Island. Like, how did this all work, you know? But I really was thinking specifically about my mom, who was from Brooklyn and had very diverse friends. And when I was growing up, her friends would come to the house who had all different backgrounds, all, you know, racially, ethnically, all different. And she really encouraged me to go to a camp, which is something I was thinking about when I was 13 and 14. So if you think I'm 65 now, the years I was 13 and 14 were kind of wild years. And the camp I went to, actually, there were counselors who, you know, had been involved with Cuban sort of revolutionary politics. One of the counselors was a Black Panther who would talk about the Black Panthers. The campers were all mostly from the city, and all different race and ethnicity. And, you know, we're all living together in camp and becoming friends. And I didn't really think that much about the impact that had on me until later. But I think in general, my mother wasn't sort of so articulate about her passion around diversity and inclusion, but it sort of seeped into everything. We had, even where I grew up, my next door neighbors were Chinese American, and there was a German family, there was an Italian family. It was like my mother purposefully chose where I lived based on that. And, you know, it's just like these little things that I just over the years have reflected back on. I realized it's not like a total accident that I ended up
right.
doing what
you
I've
were
done.
groomed.
Yeah, no, without realizing it.
You were groomed into the position that made you who you are today.
Yeah, I think so. I think more.
And then I love the overlap of your art. That's also part, by the way, we have some beautiful pieces of art here. They're sculptures that Wendy has created. I know that you call them puppets, but I believe that they come alive in their own right, that she's created an inclusive environment right here in our studio with the different various colors of the skin and the hair and the clothes. So would you like to talk a little bit about your...
Yeah, I actually, what I call the puppet project was my COVID project. I really hadn't done really figurative art for many, many years, but I was trying to kind of integrate my two different lives together when I started the puppets. So I purposefully was making puppets that were black and Asian and different, you know, different skin colors, different aspects. You know, I tried my, you know, all different directions in terms of diversity. Mm-hmm. And my goal, I kind of achieved to some extent, but COVID sort of put a little bit of a clamp on it. But I was donating the puppets to various organizations. Actually, one organization that I gave puppets to is Our Children in Astoria, Queens, where it's a program where women who are formerly incarcerated are reconnecting with their children. Mm. So I gave them these little finger puppets, animals and different things. I donated them also, that type of puppet, to a Harlem-based organization that's a health organization for the children of the Hotel Workers Union. Mm-hmm. And they had some big events. You know, I just was trying to kind of do something with societal concerns and my art, you know, which felt sure. like the best way to integrate my two lives, because right. my lives were pretty different. Ernst & Young, I'm like wearing a suit. The next day, I'm like sitting on the floor with my drill. You know, it's kind of like a little different. So.
So there's two homes, really, in a sense. Right?
Mm, that's a good point.
You're looking at where you bring a certain level of professionalism to your work, and mm-hmm. you're dressing a certain way, and then you go home, you let it all hang out, and there's yeah. a completely different home. If you were to walk into your home, would you, at that time when you were working, would you see any reflection of mm. Ernst Young in your environment, or would it just be, this is Wendy the artist?
Well, actually, I've pretty much had separate studios from my home. Except when I was younger, and I was thinking about this, you know, I was sort of struggling with the home concept at first, but what I realized is, as a young artist, my priority was my studio. So, for example, I lived on the Bowery above Houston Street in an no central heated loft for 3 years after I graduated from undergrad. And I was so happy because I had this big studio. I actually had a wood-burning stove in New York City.
What?
I had this huge studio. And my room lit was like horrible, where I had my, you know, home stuff. So that is like the absolute perfect example of where my head was at as a younger person. And over time, you know, I would have to say that thinking about home to me has more to do with relationships with people than physical space, which I feel guilty saying to somebody who has the skills you have.
it's about relationship, really.
Yeah, but that's what I realized is, you know, I'm the kind of person that connects people to each other. So mm-hmm. I realized, like, one of my best feelings of home is really when my friends all get to know each other, and I have that sense of almost like an invented family of my own. It's
very beautiful. Yeah, that's beautiful, so. The connection between the people who all have something in common, perhaps, and mm-hmm. a common denominator. And I can see that, like the sparks flying in your environment where when everybody is together, because you have such a beautiful energy yourself.
Aww.
You have a beautiful smile. And then it shows, it shines. Going back to these wonderful, I don't want to call them puppets, but they are puppets. They're people. They really do have such an incredible life of their own. How many of these have you made?
Oh, wow. I really was passionately making them during the pandemic. So I had a couple years of massive production. I think probably, I would say maybe 150 something.
And I know you have a website, wendyhirschberg.com, correct? And then you also have a YouTube site, which is where you showcase these puppets, correct?
Right. The website gives you a sense of like the my oldest work on the website might be from the early 90s. Mm-hmm. So you could see the found object and more abstract sculpture that I've made over the different years. But the puppet project, definitely you can see on the website, I think, the more integrated part of it where I, not the website, meaning, I'm sorry, the YouTube.
The YouTube.
Because I used an app that is meant for and like your pets talking to you. And I photographed the puppets and I put them into this app, so I was able to do a voiceover. And so the puppets appear as if they're speaking, and they're actually talking about challenges they face as an African-American person or as a, a person with a complex challenge related to diversity. So they're little brief statements that I made.
Beautiful overlap of your artistry and your diversity inclusive.
Yeah. I was channeling a lot of people because I, of course, listened a lot to understand what was really going on and in each of the different networks that I was working with. And I also, what I was doing, which I think really built trust, was I was understanding how to become successful within Ernst & Young. It was a pretty complex place to navigate. So I was able to offer my coaching insights around the career strategies and at the same time develop trust and relationships so I could understand really where the exclusion was happening, the unconscious bias or the different common experiences that were, happening for a lot of diverse people, and that was what I spoke to in the puppet project. I was really channeling other people.
One last little thing, we're going to wrap up soon. We have this wonderful segment called I Got a Guy,
right?
Or I Got a Gal. And it's a fun, that's where you tag the next guest on the show. And so, Wendy, do you have a guy or a gal?
A guy.
Okay, let's hear about it.
Okay, my cousin actually is who I thought of. He is Dylan Skolnick. Some of the folks here may know him. He runs now with his 92-year-old mom the Cinema Arts Center in Huntington.
Okay.
And that's really a long-term Long Island institution that my aunt and uncle started. Above a Salvation Army in Huntington
way back, and it's now in a beautiful multi-theater complex. And my cousin Dylan is really fascinating. I think you'll totally enjoy. He's a lovely man, and he's done really interesting things with his life, so I think that'll be a lot of fun for you.
Oh, thank you so much. And also, I would love to know, your relationship growing up with Dylan,
well, I actually, am, I think, 11 years older. So my first relationship with him was actually babysitting a little bit. Which I can tease him
okay,
about.
Okay, Dylan.
But, no, as a, I mean, he grew up inside the cinema. So, he and his family really were a little bit challenging to integrate into our family because they would always be in some 12-hour cinema event in New York City when it was a holiday or those sorts of things. But So there were some times when it was harder for me to be in touch with Dylan, but Dylan is very close to my son, Miles Emmanuel, and also has become, you know, a really beloved member of my family, and I've gotten close to him and actually worked with him on a diversity inclusion challenge that was in the film arena. So I'm a huge fan.
Well, thank you for that tag. And tag Dylan, you're it on the Mind Body Home Show. But it seems like we're running out of time. And I just want to thank you, Wendy, for being here today and just inspiring us with all the work that you've done. And we just pretty much cleaned the surface of your life. But it's such a, if anybody wants to get in touch with Wendy and would like to connect with her, you can go to her website, wendyhirschberg.com, and also see her wonderful puppets in action on her YouTube channel. Truly a remarkable thing where you can combine two worlds and call it your home, and the home that you've created is the relationships that you've built and with different people at work and in your life. So thanks again, Wendy.
Absolutely, my pleasure.
I have a gal for you, Joan, and her name is Wendy Hirschberg. She's always been a sculptor, and now she's working with puppets and does shows, and she'll tell you all about it.